So this year was different from the previous years in the sense that it was a virtual meeting, and it means for a lot of people that the interaction with colleagues is different. But in spite of all this, the news that was presented at ASH was exciting. And why was it exciting? Because I think we are now at the brink of entering a new era with immune therapies in multiple myeloma. For a long time, there was the promise of immune therapies, and it started, of course, with novel agents like the IMiDs, lenalidomide, pomalidomide, and also, in a sense, the antibodies like daratumumab and isatuximab. But right now, we also see the start of the cellular therapies with CAR T cells that were already presented last year, but now in a more mature state. And we also see the entrance of new bispecific agents that I will comment on in just a while. So all this makes the whole field of myeloma very exciting, even more than before, because we will observe a change to new ways to treat patients. Yeah, so the EMN-02 trial has been started in 2011 already. It is a trial of the European Myeloma Network, independent trial, so not guided by industry. And the goal of this, the aim of this trial was to look at the role of high-dose therapy compared with standard chemo in newly diagnosed patients that were transplant eligible. And the results have been presented and also already published in June of this year with first author Dr. Cavo. The main outcome of that part of the trial was that intensive therapy with high-dose melphalan and autologous transplant improves the progression-free survival, the response rate, and as has been presented now at ASH, also the overall survival. The other part of the study concerned the role of consolidation therapy after the transplant. Patients were randomized again, the second randomization, between two cycles of VRd consolidation or no consolidation. All patients then received maintenance with lenalidomide. And the outcome of the final analysis of this part of the trial is that the consolidation therapy with VRd improves progression-free survival, a median of 59 versus 43 months after the second randomization. Also, we see a much better response rate and higher quality of response, more CRs, more stringent CRs. And this at the cost of almost no toxicity. So taken together, we also observe that the benefit of consolidation occurs across the different subgroups, the prognostic groups, like cytogenetics, ISS states, and other predefined variables. This is the first trial that prospectively investigated the role of consolidation therapy in newly diagnosed multiple myeloma. And I think that consolidation will earn a place in the treatment, the standard treatment of patients in combination with autologous transplant. Unfortunately, there are no other trials that address this question. But what we observe now is that in most trials that are currently being conducted in Europe and outside Europe, consolidation is included in the treatment regimen. Yeah, so the Apollo trial is a trial in relapsed refractory patients. For the first time, a combination of daratumumab with pomalidomide and dexamethasone. This study was conducted by the European Myeloma Network and recently concluded. The results have been presented now at ASH for the first time. the main outcome was progression-free survival, and we observed that the risk of progression or death is reduced by 36% in the group that had daratumumab subcutaneously added to Pom-Dex. So this is a very good result. We also saw that the response quality, especially the CR or better rate, was much higher with Dara Pom-Dex as compared with Pom-Dex, 25% versus 4%, and also a higher MRD, minimal residual disease negativity rate. So if we look to the specific group of patients that were already refractory to lenalidomide, and this group is increasing because of the widespread use of lenalidomide in earlier lines, then we can see that specifically in this group, the PFS is prolonged by adding Dara subcutaneously to Pom-Dex. The safety profile was very much acceptable and comparable with the already known safety profile of Dara sub-Q. So taken together, we conclude that Dara sub-Q subcutaneously plus Pom-Dex is an effective and a convenient treatment for patients with relapsed refractory myeloma who have already received one or more prior lines of therapy, including lenalidomide and a PI like bortezomib. Yeah, so there are a number of new agents that are currently being investigated and were presented at ASH, and one of those is belantamab mafodotin that has recently been approved for treatment of patients with late stage of the disease, like beyond third line of therapy. This is a conjugate of antibody to BCMA with a toxic agent that may eliminate plasma cells. It's very effective, so 31% response is observed in fourth line and later. And also, the responses are durable. There's one disadvantage of this, and that's the keratopathy. So it affects the vision with blurred vision and other symptoms, dry eyes like that. So patients who receive belantamab should also be followed by an ocular specialist. However, the symptoms are transient, the ocular symptoms, and most of the patients recover within a few months. Again, a very effective agent, but the treatment should be performed in very close observation with an ocular specialist. There are also other new agents in the same class, like B-specific agents such as teclistamab and talquetamab, that engage other proteins on the plasma cell, on the myeloma plasma cell, not only BCMA, but also GPR5D, with very promising results, high response rates, almost no toxicity. And these agents have now been tested in phase 1 and phase 2 trials and will proceed to extensive testing in phase 2 and phase 3 trials. So lots of news, also other new agents that I'm not going to discuss because of time, but I think over the next 1 or 2 years, we will see the clinical results of the use of those new agents, not only in relapsed refractory myeloma, but gradually also in newly diagnosed patients. Yeah, so amyloidosis is a very rare disease. It's one of the diseases in the plasma cell dyscrasia, but rare, relatively rare. And many patients with amyloidosis are diagnosed rather late because of the difficulty in identifying the disease and because not every physician is familiar with it. So we in the European Myeloma Network conducted a retrospective analysis of patients with amyloidosis in the participating countries in Europe. And this study was conducted by Dr. Kastritis from Athens in Greece, who is a highly esteemed specialist for this disease. So when he analyzed the records of patients, a total of more than 2,800 patients were collected, and the diagnostic procedures, the diagnostic data, as well as the treatment regimens and the outcome of treatment were collected and presented at ASH. I will not go into all the details because this will be discussed by Dr. Merlini and Dr. Palladini from the European Myeloma Network. But one outstanding or two outstanding results is that we could see that bortezomib-based regimens are now the most widely used for this disease, and this is good. So the response rates, especially in patients that can tolerate autologous transplant, are also good with CRs up to 40%, but patients without autologous transplant have a much lower response rate. So there's still work to do there. Also, one thing that was clear is that patients with stage 3B have a very dismal prognosis. These are patients with extensive organ involvement who usually are diagnosed too late. And their prognosis is bad, with a short overall survival and poor outcome of treatment, whatever is given. So these are very important data, also in order to prepare for future treatment protocols for these patients and to perform studies in this group of still unmet medical needs.